All right, Tim, most shows start with an intro. This is the most unprofessional show you're ever going to be on. And I'm going to assume that anybody watching this knows who you are, but I'm still going to throw you some intro because Tim founded Meaning of Catholic. He's also the editor at 1 Peter 5, and he is one of my favorite people in the world. Meaning of Catholic is the only channel or apostolate that I patronize. We have the guild over there. All the things that you're doing over there are like unbelievably edifying for me, man. I've learned a lot from your channel. You're part of the reason that I started doing this, because there's so many people talking about all the terrible things going on in the church, and then I watch some of this stuff and I learn things on your channel, you know? So that's pretty much why I love your channel so much.
Thanks, man.
So I know most of your stuff. Like, I know you went from, you were raised Protestant, then you went, I think you went to Islam and Eastern Orthodox, then finally Catholic, right?
I was never a Mohammedan. So
you looked into it.
Never really seriously. I looked into it as sort of a curiosity about just learning about other religions. I never really questioned Jesus Christ. But it was like, well, what are their arguments?
Okay. Basically. So it was more from just a curiosity standpoint. Now, where was your wife through all of that?
She converted to Catholicism before I did. She was Catholic when I was Eastern Orthodox. And then we met at, I started actually going to this Catholic young adult group that she led at a parish before I was Catholic. And I was later came into Catholicism, and that's when we really became friends at that point. So it was after all this. Yeah. After all that, we didn't have to endure all that crazy religious shifting over the years.
Yeah. So my wife was Lutheran when we got married, and she was good enough to allow me to take, like, I didn't even take my faith that seriously when we got married, but I was like, something in me was like, no, we have to get married in a Catholic church. And it was kind of an issue with her family, but she was still like, all right, I'll do what you say, you know? And then a couple of years into our marriage, I had like a major, I guess a reversion or a conversion, but whatever. And she wasn't there for the ride for me in the beginning. And then it took a couple of years, and then she came into the church and on her own, though. Like, I didn't want to tell her to do anything. Like, she kind of had to get there on her own. So there was a couple of rough years there where we weren't on the same page, you know?
Right on.
So I'm always interested to see how people's wives handle things. So the other day I was watching the Pope documentary that CNN put out. It's on HBO, and it's way better done than I thought. I was expecting to be appalled the whole documentary. I was like, it starts off as a Francis love fest, which, I mean, honestly, I want them to respect the office anyway. But then when Liam Neeson is actually doing the narrating, they go from the first century and they get into Constantine. And one of the commenters mentions Constantine and says, well, you know, all these Caesars in the first century, they really thought of themselves as high priest also. So that's kind of how Constantine saw himself. And I'm going, oh, they actually got that right, you know? So I wanted you to just talk about the idea of the Pontifex Maximus.
Yeah.
So the Pontifex Maximus was a theme you had in your book that I had never even heard before. And it blew me away because you see how it has a lot to do with the split between East and West.
Yeah, and that was something that I discovered. I did not even realize that at that point, because when you study East and West apologetics, like Eastern Orthodoxy versus Catholicism and whatnot, it's so focused solely on these isolated theological issues, and they isolate them from all of the cultural, political, economic developments that are going on in all these different factors. And those have significant effect on the whole question.
Yeah.
And one of the misconceptions that is raised is, so for example, what they do is they say, well, the Pope, the papal office just sort of gained power over the first millennium and in the second millennium especially. And that's actually true. But what they don't tell you is that that power was in response to the growing secular power trying to take over the church. So the papacy continued to gain more power or sort of reach more for more power to protect the church against state encroachment, and really to bring the church out of state encroachment in the first place, because really every ancient culture has this sort of priest king figure, because eventually whoever is the king takes over. Like you have Pharaoh. Pharaoh was also a high priest. He was a king and a high priest. The same thing was in the Persian Empire, other places. You have the same thing in the Chinese Empire. You have this imperial figure who is priest and king. Now, this is also a type of Christ, because Christ himself obviously is that priest and king. But in Caesar Augustus took for himself this traditional title, which in Latin is Pontifex Maximus. That's the high priesthood, as a part of the establishing of the Roman Empire, transitioning from the Roman Republic in the first century BC. And so, yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, so you see language. Well, first off, I want you to tell people what a triumph is. Like, so as they would come and conquer a place, they would have a triumph, right?
Yes. So this was, and I first credit again, where credit where it's due here. I actually read this in the Ignatius Study Bible randomly one day. They just had this little piece that they talked about this term triumph. And there's two instances where St. Paul uses the term triumph in Greek, which is this verb form of a religious ritual that's a pagan ritual by the Romans that they would do to preach their gospel, that they call it, of the Son of God. And the triumph was a religious ritual that dates back at least to Alexander the Great, but the origins are Dionysus was this performed this triumph. And the triumph is where you basically have a religious parade, but it's a huge deal. And it's not like a parade we talk about today. Parades are not nothing compared to those parades, but you would have this parade where the emperor would parade in with all of his retinue, and he would have the conquered kings that he had conquered. He would parade them up in front of the whole procession, and it would be a whole religious rituals that would come through the town, and they would have games and food and bread and circuses and all this. And then they would ritually kill these kings as a part of this spectacle. And it would just be a celebration of the fact that this Pontifex Maximus, the high priest who's doing this religious ritual, had brought peace to the world, and he had conquered the enemies. And then they raised a huge triumph arch just to commemorate the fact that they had a triumph. So these triumph arches have a depiction of the fact that they did a triumph. So it's so huge that they had to make a massive stone structure just to remember the fact that they did this ritual for everybody who wasn't fortunate enough to be there at the spectacle. So this
they can at least go and see the commemoration of it.
Yeah. So this is the type of this is the type of spectacle that really wowed the ancient world. This is the type of thing that really got people really riled up and made them believe in this gospel of the Roman Empire.
Yeah, and then you see St. Paul using the language of triumph in his letters. So you see the pontiff, well, really the Pontifex Maximus is an appropriate term for the Pope, right? Because he is high priest and he is the ruler over the Catholic Church. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, so he is the head priest of the church. That's correct. And there's even, I mean, you could even say the Pontifex Maximus of a region would be the particular bishop who would be ruling over that region or something like that. And the question in the first millennium is, who is the Pontifex Maximus of the whole church? Is it the Pope or is it the emperor?
Yeah. That's, and anytime you see the secular ruler try to take that title on for himself, you start to see some problems. Now, you had one of the most interesting theories I ever heard about the split between East and West. And I've used this when talking to people, because when you look at how the Catholic Church was formed, it was literally modeled after the Roman Empire. So you had, even look during the Gospels, you have Caesar in Rome, and then you have these outposts, and these outposts have governors or rulers in different, but they are ruling on behalf of the Caesar. So what do you have the church modeled as? You have the Pope in Rome, and then you have the bishops as these outposts of the Roman Empire. Like, we are the new Roman Empire. So when you started to explain how the Roman mind was able to incorporate cultures, and the Greek mind has an amazing philosophical mind, but they're not able to allow a culture to remain themselves. And that's a big part of the reason the East split from the West.
Absolutely. And this is the other factor that is not discussed in these theological controversies. But this is critical, because at the point when the division was most acute in the 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th century, not only were the Eastern Orthodox bringing up the Filioque, but the Filioque was just one among many issues that they were bringing up, such as unleavened bread, priests without beards, fasting on Saturday, wearing bad hats.
Yeah.
All sorts of ridiculous things that have nothing to do with the faith. We all know that the Greeks were going east of themselves and west, because they said of the Armenians, they said, well, the Armenians eat eggs on this day, but we fast to refute their heresy.
Yeah, none of these things are doctrinal. None of them have to do with dogma. They're these little weird things that they're accusing the West of heresy over. And you can see even how, like, when we talk about uniting the East and West, it would be like, how do you even unite the East to each other?
Yeah, exactly.
They have all these little divisions amongst each other.
Here's the thing, is that the West also did that. The Franks did have the same prejudices. They were bringing up the same prejudices with the Greeks, because they were trying to bolster their own empire. But the Roman mind cannot tolerate that type of parochialism, or that provincialism, that myopia of your culture. The Roman mind is uniting these different cultures, because the Roman mind distinguishes between what is non-essential and unessential.
Yeah, so if people don't understand that, so like when Rome conquers Greece, they don't make the Greeks become strictly Roman. They allow them to remain Greek.
Yeah, and so this was going on for hundreds of years before the church became like St. Constantine the Great. So the empire was ruling. Their genius was to administer their conquered territories, all they had to do was, we're going to conquer this territory. All you have to do is pay your taxes and pinch incense to Caesar, and you can just have your own religion, your own culture, whatever you want to do. Just get along, and we're not going to mess with your culture. And that's what the Roman model has would been going on for centuries.
Yeah, and that's proper enculturation. So, you know, some of the nonsense you see now, that's not. So they would go and not force the Greeks to become Roman. They would be Roman citizens after they came in, but they would allow that. So that's why the Greek culture was still allowed to exist, even though they were under Roman occupation, you know? So the other thing I mentioned the instance of Artemis of Ephesia in another video I did, because I love typology, but typology isn't just the Old Testament revealed in the New. It's the way reality unfolds to us. It's a pattern. And when I started reading about some of the ways they would worship Artemis, and the priests wearing women's clothing and castrating themselves, it just made me see how these old rituals are coming back. But they're not calling it worship to Artemis, but you just see these certain patterns reemerging from the past. And it really, like, I was like, wow, you know, when I started reading that, and it made me just start looking at other, it really got me interested in seeing how that has happened over history. I started looking at the fall of the Roman Empire, some of the similarities, and you see towards the end of the Roman Empire, they lost their belief in the pagan gods. And that led to their cultural decline also, you know. But the biggest thing that your book did was blackpilled me on America. because you see from its inception, we always had the idol of money. It's like, so when I saw the trade, when I look back on the Trade Center incident, I almost see that as like when Assyria destroys the temple, like God raises up our enemies and destroys the Trade Center. And we should have went into a mode of repentance at that point. And just seeing how we've always idolized money instead of, instead of preaching the gospel, we go and we spread democracy. Like, I don't see how a civilization, we all think that America was founded on God, but no, we're kind of all idol worshipers here, you know?
Yeah. The part of the book is trying to look at ancient idols and see how those idols have been reborn in just different forms, but they're really the same thing. And one of those idols, one of those gods, is Libertas. Libertas is the goddess which was worshipped by the Romans after they defeated Tarquin the Proud in the period of the ancient Roman kings. This was going back to like 500-600 BC. I don't recall the dates exactly, but it's hundreds of years before the imperial period. But they worshipped Libertas as liberty. And this becomes an idol when, especially coming out of the Dutch Republic in the 1580s, when there is a new idea born where the covenant of Christian peoples can just be broken by changing the terms of the agreement by embracing heresy. And so there's this idea of Libertas that gets reborn, which is kind of a rationalization for voluntarism. It's a rationalization for imposing your will on a situation and just saying, well, I'm following Libertas, liberty. And so this is ultimately the Roman goddess, which is erected in the harbor in New York City. The
Statue of Liberty.
It's modeled on the same Roman goddess, and it's not an accident because it is an idol.
Yeah. Yeah, they and you also go and you really show how when you separate money from logos, that's when things really go wrong.
Yeah, the ancient mind understood. I try to show how the ancient mind understood this objectification of woman, as well as just any like a slave, other people as well, even children, objectification of all weaker parties for the advantage of the stronger party. And so that's just by definition a voluntarist transaction. There's no logos involved in that. It's just the stronger dominating the weaker. And so it's the idea that might makes right. Justice is just a matter of the stronger imposing their will on the lower. And so that's a complete denial of any rational order of the universe whatsoever. So the Christian model, the gospel, transformed the idea of money so that it's money is not merely, or economics in general, is not merely a bunch of different parties imposing their will on each other, but it money itself is a corrupting influence. Money, the love of money, is the root of all evil. And that's the understanding that the church brought to economics. And this transformed economics so that economics could have its own logos, and it could serve the common good and truly protect the weaker parties in all of these things. Because now when you have an economic transaction, you're always going to have a stronger party and a weaker party in every economic transaction practically. Yeah. So there's always going to be a stronger and weaker. So there's always going to be the stronger and weaker, but the logos is introduced so that money is not that corrupting influence, which is so destructive because people want this power, and money is power. It's the instantiation of power.
You really don't like when you hear atheists talk about how they do not understand how transformative Christianity was. They don't they think that we would have came up with our own moral framework, you know, just based off of, you know, Greco-Roman culture without Christianity entering the picture. They really have no idea how much every thought we have is, even the idea of even with the Black Lives Matter riots, things like that going on, the idea that we should protect the weak and look out for the disenfranchised is such a Christian idea. It would have been so alien to a culture before us. There was never a culture in history where you looked out for the downtrodden. Right? I mean,
that? A great example is the fact that the certain Roman philosophers like Seneca, they could understand that a slave was a person. They can understand that. I mean, people can understand it. You can't.
Yeah, that's reason.
Make up this ideology that a slave is not a person because he's obviously a person. But what the Roman philosophers could not do was actually inspire and transform the entire slave economy.
Yeah.
With that idea, that's what Christianity was able to do, and that's how the Christianity freed the slaves twice. Christianity first transformed the whole slave economies into an interdependent hierarchical system of economy where the weaker, there's a hierarchy means sacred order, which is where the lower serves the higher, but the higher is charged with taking care of the lower in a hierarchy. But then, as you say, like the Enlightenment thinkers, they actually use Christian principles to critique the transatlantic slave trade, which had infected Christendom with the poison of Mohammedan racism, basically. And it actually uses Christian principles to critique the degradation of Christendom. But they don't realize that it's actually Christian principles that they're using. All of these modern concepts that people are using to critique the Catholic Church are actually Catholic principles that were born by Christianity.
Yeah, if it wasn't for Christianity, that's the slave trade never would have ended in America. It was actually Protestant. It was a Protestant movement to end slavery in America, because America was never a Catholic country. I know the Pope always condemned it, but it was a mainly Protestant effort to end slavery in America.
Yeah. I mean, most people in America were Protestant, but the slavery issue was it began to infect the Catholic Church because they bad Catholics were wanting to imitate the Mohammedan slave trade, so they got involved with it, and the excesses were always condemned, but there was some toleration and there was some corruption involved. But the church was always fighting against this slave trade to cleanse it of its evil, to reconcile slave and master as brothers, and to bring them to the same altar. But I think the contrast with dealing with the transatlantic slave corruption in the Catholic and Protestant world shows especially where the gospel is different, because you have slavery infecting the Spanish Christendom of the Americas, as well as the Portuguese Christendom. It's infecting this racial ideology from the Mohammedans, but it actually gets nullified by the gospel. So the church was not able to stop the Frenchmen in New Orleans from having slaves because they were bad Catholics, but it forced the slaves, forced them to stop the slaves from working on Sundays and holy days, and they intermarried. And this is the key. They were able to intermarry, which is totally not at all the case in the United States. They never intermarried. They had shadow families where they were, you know, fornicating with the slaves. They never intermarried and created this.
The idea of racism in America is very unique to America because of Protestantism. So in all the Catholic countries, you were allowed, once somebody was baptized, you were allowed to have intermarriage, where in the Protestant states, that was never the case. Like, it was very frowned upon to have a situation like that.
Yeah, I mean, they had some Anglo Protestants intermarried with some Indians and some Blacks. It happened, but it never created any sort of anything like the mestizo culture of Mexico. Yeah. Mexico is entirely intermarried. They're all all of the Spanish and Portuguese Christendom, it's all intermarried into one big culture, which can be unified with one altar. Whereas the Protestants, they cannot deal with that. They can't actually, they cannot nullify the effects of slavery. And so we have BLM to this day because they're able to, because there actually was real racism that was preventing people from reconciling with each other. And it's been this long legacy of public racism and then shadow families in the darkness where you are actually fathering children with these slaves, which is wicked. Yeah. And it cannot be dealt with. So it's, I think that contrast really shows the power of the Catholic Church, because they're fighting against slavery, but even if slavery gets introduced by corruption, it will be nullified by the gospel and by the Catholic faith.
Yeah. Now there's two other things I want to talk to you about before we go. One of them is the idea of second Christendom. I had never heard it put the way you put it, how while you have the Reformation going on in England and Europe is, Christendom is falling apart in Europe. And then all of a sudden you have second Christendom being built in the Americas that were just discovered.
Yeah.
I'd never heard it put that way. And it blew my mind. I was like,
and
wow.
This is as a result of a longstanding bias against Spanish Christendom so all the English historians, there's still not enough. There's so much English in the Anglophone universe. There's so much bias against Spanish Christendom that people just don't know about this.
Yeah,
because there's been the Anglican Church has been propagandizing against it for centuries now. And it actually came from an Anglo-Spanish historian, Henry Sear. He's Spanish and English. And he wrote Phoenix from the Ashes. And he was the one who really brought this out in a way that I had never seen before, was that the fact that basically the Protestant Reformation or revolt was a failure by 1600. It really had sputtered into nothing. The Catholics had beat them back even on the continent.
With the Jesuits.
It was really only in England or Sweden that there was still Protestantism. It was on the decline, basically. And then there was second Christendom, which is the whole Baroque civilization of the Spanish Christendom and the Portuguese Christendom in the Americas, as well as elsewhere. It was also happening on the continent in Austria, Italy, Spain, especially. France was in rebellion against Trent. So there's a problems in France that erupted in the French Revolution. But there was this new Christendom, which was new. It was like bigger and better, so to speak.
Yeah.
And it's really glorious that the church really counterattacked the Protestants and grew something quite beautiful and amazing that the Protestants really, they could not compete with. They couldn't create an alternative civilization. They had to resort to a bunch of lies and calumnies and violence.
Yeah, well, what you see is because they have a united cultus, like you said, like that's what makes me so worried about America. Like, we've never had that. We've all agreed on like a basic moral framework, but we've never had a true American culture. You actually helped develop my whole idea of what a culture is. There's four parts to a culture. I'm going to butcher it. I'm going to let you say what it is. Do you remember it offhand?
Sure. Yeah. This is from Christopher Dawson. So just go read Christopher Dawson. I'm trying to boil down what he says into these four parts. But the cultus is the most important part of culture. It's, if you don't have a cultus, which is a religious right to the deity, you cannot have a culture at all. There's no culture known to man that has ever not had a religious right. So right there, America falls flat because it has no religious right supplicating the divine. So it's already some form of deforming of culture. So you not only have the religious right, but then you have the tradition, everything that's passed down. And then you have this office of priesthood or elders who pass down the tradition. And then you have the virtue of piety in the next generation, which connects them all together. Yeah.
So these are all things we have a big problem with in our current situation. So before I let you go, the story of St. Patrick, I mean, we see every year everybody gets hammered out of their faces on St. Patrick's Day. We have our parades. We all wear shamrocks and wear green. When I read the story, the real story of St. Patrick, I sat my family down and I read them this story. This, I had never heard it before. I couldn't believe it. It's not even one of those things that we pass down to each other. It was so awesome to me. You do not realize how intense the battle to get Christianity into these places were, and that they were fighting up against God, demons really, but it was an intense thing that St. Patrick did.
Yeah, I love that story. It's a wonderful story of of really the Christian gospel, because Saint Patrick is he's a patricius, a Roman Briton, gets captured by these crazy Celts in Ireland. He's a slave for a while, then he escapes, but then he has a conversion experience and realizes that God was punishing him by making him this slave, and he realized that to do penance, he was going to bring the gospel back to his old slave masters and convert them all, because he saw that they were actually enslaved to demon gods by means of the Druids and their shamanism. So he goes back to Ireland and he preaches to them, but then he goes toe to toe like the prophet Elijah with the prophet.
Yeah, that's what it was. It was wild.
And he goes toe to toe with these Druids who are casting curses and spells against him. And all the demons are coming out, but he's just making the sign of the cross and destroying all the demons. And it's just a wonderful, wild ride that is always, we need to commemorate that and pray for the Irish as well.
A genuine St. Patrick's Day would be amazing, right? This St. Patrick's Day, I'm going to sit my family down and I'm going to reread that story to them, because I want them to know the real story. It's amazing how our culture is just completely degraded our sacred holidays and things that were always Catholic. Even, I mean, you know how I feel about Halloween. I'm like, I get so angry when people make it like it's a devil's holiday or something. I'm like, no, we have to restore Halloween. I want Halloween back. It bothers me. So Tim's book is a single volume church history. It goes from he basically tells it from Noah to present. If anybody has ever wanted a single volume church history, I cannot recommend this book enough. I was lucky enough to be on the launch team. I wrote a review for it. I cannot tell people enough to go get this book. I think everybody will enjoy it and love it a lot. Tim, thank you so much for coming on with me, man. I appreciate everything you guys do over there.
Thanks, brother. Appreciate it. All right.
I'll see you soon.